Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the fiscal year 2020 CSBG Annual Report Webinar Series, Part 3. Today, we'll be displaying to you guys how to fill out your SMART forms for the 2020 annual reporting season. Prior to getting started into the demo, I did want to give some updates. Next slide. We did extend the due date, as we announced last week at the NASCAS conference, as well as in our CSBG DCL 2021-10. Within that DCL, the due date was extended to June 30th, 2021 for all three reports. So that's regular CSBG, CSBG CARES, and the disaster supplemental. We also released guidance, CSBG Dear Colleague Letter, or DCL 2021-10, annual report requirements and due date extension. This was released last Thursday, March 11th, and is available on our website. And we also included information in the annual report requirements about, just as reminders and refreshers for what our requirements are for the three reports. And lastly, we do plan to open OLDC next week. We've noticed that some people have started populating module one, or some states have started populating module one. And we do want to remind you that the pre-populations are not yet available. So if you've started populating module one, we ask you to please stop. You will have to delete what you've already started in order for those populations to come through starting next week. Next slide. And I want to remind everyone, well, especially our CSBG state lead agencies, that we have a webinar on Thursday at 2 p.m. Eastern time, where we'll discuss OLDC roles, module one data entry, modules two and four report upload, and module three attachments. And I do want to apologize, I did not introduce myself. My name is Monique Alcantara. I'm with the Office of Community Services. Thank you again for joining us today. Prior to, we are also joined by the National Association for State Community Services Programs, or NASCAS. And prior to handing it over to them, I did want to give you some quick housekeeping rules. At the bottom of your screen, you'll see a Q&A pod and a chat pod. We do ask that for any questions you have to please provide, please type those questions into the Q&A pod. We will not open the session up for live questions, but we will answer your questions as we go through the presentation, and we will allow for some Q&A at the end of the presentation. I am joined today by Katie Kujawski and Muska Cameron. I saw that someone raised your hand. Please add those questions to the Q&A. We'll also be looking at the chat, but our preference is for you to add the questions into the Q&A pod. I am joined today by Katie Kujawski and Muska Cameron from NASCAS, and I will hand it over to them to begin our presentation. Thank you.
All right, thank you so much, Monique, and good afternoon, Community Action. It is really great to see you this afternoon to talk about your FY20 SMART forms. I'm Katie Kujawski, Research Director with NASCAS, and Muska has been introduced as well, and will probably introduce herself again momentarily. So before we dive into a demo of the SMART forms and some really nitty-gritty specifics about using them, we just want to provide some general information about the SMART forms and the process this year. So as of Friday, actually, we are really pleased to announce that all states who use SMART forms for reporting should have received all modules 2, 3, and 4. States that use a state database have also received Module 3 SMART forms. And if you are a state office and have not received these SMART forms, please reach out to Paige Milson at our office and CC Muska Cameron. All SMART form sends came from Paige Milson. So if you're trying to look through your inbox from last week, you can search for Paige and hopefully they'll pop up. Again, if you haven't received them, reach out to these two who can help you out. We know that there has been changeover at the state office, so sometimes they may have gone to an old contact. And agencies out there, give your states a day or two because they did just receive these forms, so it might take them a little while to turn them around and send them out to you. So at any rate, be on a lookout for those SMART forms. They have been forwarded to state offices. Another note, as Monique mentioned, OCS has extended the deadline for the state submission of the FY20 report, and in fact, both supplemental reports as well, to June 30th, 2021. So for local agencies out there on the call, note that your submission date to your state office will likely be, well, it should be sooner, right? So that your state can then do the review and turn around the submission to OCS by that deadline. We encourage any early submission, if possible, based on your state processes. And NASCASP is always here to help the state offices and if you need anything in terms of review or the process in general for that matter. So the SMART forms are unique to you, right? They're unique to each state. So when states receive the SMART forms, you know, make sure that they say your state name on them. For example, local agencies, when you get those SMART forms, make sure you see your local agency name. And why is that important? Well, we've populated each SMART form with an eligibility name and a DUNS number and your previous year data. And this is important for the upload process to OLDC, and then also your data review process, right? You want to be comparing apples to apples there. So if you notice any anomaly, reach out to Muska and she can help sort out any issue that might be out there. The process for 20 is the same as it has been. Local agencies will complete filling out their SMART forms, review their data, and send those forms to their state offices, where states will do yet another review, and they will export that SMART form data to an XML format for upload into OLDC. The Module 3 is slightly different in that it's an attachment of the file. There's no export process needed. And just a couple of notes on the things that are in SMART forms. There's an instructions tab, an errors and warnings tab. You can see your previous year's data. There's buttons to enable functionality. And Muska, I'm gonna turn it over to her, who's going to do a live demo of module 2 and 4. And I think we're gonna look at 3 as well.
Awesome. Thanks, Katie. And hello, Community Action. As Katie said, I'm also super excited to be here and walk through the SMART forms with you guys. So let's just dive in. I am going to have to exit out of the slideshow and go straight to the form. So we're going to do the demo, but just to note, we do have resources posted on our website. So you'll obviously always be able to take a look at this recording if you're a first-time user and aren't familiar with the forms, but we also have lots of great tools and resources on our website. So feel free to check those out, and we're going to walk through those tools and resources at the end also. So let's start with Module 2. With any of the forms that you receive, you always want to make sure that before you do anything else, you click the Enable Content button up top there. And that's because there's a lot of macros and coding that is built into the forms there. So we want those to work, right? We want the validations to work for you guys, so you know where the errors and warnings are popping up. And in order to do that, you need to be able to click on that Enable Content button. Sometimes it might say Enable Editing, but for the most part, it will say Enable Content. You want to click on it. If you do not see the Enable Content button, that is a huge red flag and you need to pause there. And if you're a local agency, you need to reach out to your state office and state offices, please reach out to NASCAP, because if you do not see the Enable Content button, that means that your form does not actually have the coding built in. Sometimes that happens when we send the forms out and through state email systems or whatever, you know, some of that coding gets stripped away. And the reason that's really critical is because if you put in your data without all of that coding, you're going to have to manually re-enter it into the correct form because you will not be able to upload to OLDC. That coding is also what allows for it to be uploaded into OLDC. So first thing first, you definitely want to make sure that you have that Enable Content button before anything else. So in this case, we do have it, which means great, we can move forward. Every tab or every form, as Katie said, is going to have that instructions tab. There's just a general overview. And then right next to it, you're going to have an outstanding errors and warnings tab. For the most part, it's going to be empty. In module two, we do have a couple errors and warnings that are just standard baseline already built in. And as you enter data, those may or may not go away. But basically, as you go through the tabs and start putting in the data, this tab over here on the outstanding errors and warnings is going to start piling up all of those warnings that are showing up in your data. So you want to go through each tab. I'm using a blank form for the purpose of demonstration. So notice that we're not going to see the name and the state name and the DUNS here. So like Katie said, again, you want to absolutely make sure that those identifying fields are already pre-populated for you. If they are not, again, it will become difficult to be uploaded into OLDC. So always check for the enable content button and then check for your name, state name, and DUNS number. Because this is a blank form, you know, we don't have previous year data on this right side right now because we didn't want to show any agency's actual data. But your forms will also come pre-populated with your fiscal year 19 data if you had provided fiscal year 19 data. If you're a new agency and you've never submitted data before, or for whatever reason you didn't have data in a particular section for fiscal year 19, obviously that data will not show up. But for the most part, you should see your forms pre-populated with this. So three things to check for: the enable content button, your name, state name, done, and then your previous year data. And once you check for all those of those three things, then you know that your forms are good to go and you can start putting in the data. For the eligible entity reporting period, real quick, you want to make sure you check the right one. It might come pre-checked just because that's how the forms are generated. So you always just want to make sure that you are taking a look at that and clicking the one that is actually applicable to you as an agency. Other than that, you start putting in data. And, you know, if you have previous year data to compare your current year data to, you'll have highlighting show up if there's a significant variation from your previous year data. And we'll show that in screenshots after the demo. Again, those are just warnings. Those are just things that are flagged for you to take a look at. It does not mean that the data is absolutely incorrect. So a lot of times you just need to take a look at it and make sure that that the data is correct before you submit it to your state office. So for example, let me say I put in $100,000 here. I put in some funds for agency capacity building and notice it instantly became highlighted yellow. Yellow means there's a warning. It means that there's something that's potentially happening here that you need to check it out. Red, if it's highlighted red, and I'll show that to you more so in module four, that means there is an error, which in 99.9% of cases means you should not submit your data with something that is flagged red, because that just means it just logically cannot be possible. But notice we have an error here, it highlighted yellow. So you wanna just scroll and that comment bar there just tells you right what the error is. It says the value entered is greater than last year. That's because it's comparing it to the previous year. And then another error you notice right over here in 8.4.1 automatically pops up and it says you must select at least one checkbox since you reported funds in 8.2i, right? And notice that that is in red and it is labeled an error, not a warning, which means you absolutely must fix this before you submit it to your state office if you're an agency. If you're a state office and you notice this in your agency's forms, you must address this before you submit it to OLDC. And that's because the way this form is set up is if you list any funds for agency capacity building, you just have to tell us what those funds were. And that's just the way that the form operates. So that's just a quick demo of the forms. And again, going through Section B. Notice that you have state name and DUNS here again. Your reporting period you don't need to check it off on every single tab. Once you check it off on the first tab, it will automatically carry over to the other tab. So nothing to do there. But you just want to go through and you want to just make sure you are filling this out completely. Notice that there are already a couple checks built in already into the form, and Katie will go through those with you once we get past the demo. If there are places where you need to specify other, you have a narrative box there and you should be filling out those narrative boxes. And then for Section B in Module 2, you'll enter in all the various funding sources you have, and of course the form will auto calculate the totals for you. So that's just a quick demo of Module 2. And of course, you want to always go back to your errors and warnings tab. That should be the last step that you always do. Notice that once I put in the data, we got a couple more errors and warnings listed here, right? So as you fill out your data, as you hit save, those errors and warnings will be compiled in a list here for you, and you want to go through that list. And you want to make sure that you address it with your state office, either by providing comments or whatever it is, and we'll walk through the comment process as well later on after this demo. But you want to make sure you go through this list of errors and warnings and have addressed it. Sometimes something might be flagged and it's perfectly correct. There's nothing for you to change there, and that is fine. You just need to make a note letting your state office know that that data is in fact correct. So once you've done all of those checks and you're at the point, if you're an agency, you just submit this entire form to your state office. Your state office then should go through and review the form. They might reach back out to you to get some clarification on errors and warnings if you did not provide the clarification yourself. And if you're a state office and you are submitting to OLDC, then the last step for you is to go to the Outstanding Errors and Warnings tab and to export the XML. You cannot submit this form into OLDC. State offices must extract the XML from the form and upload that XML into OLDC. So you're going to click the XML export button. It's going to pop up this window, and all you need to do is select a folder that you want it to go into. I'm going to tell it to go into my downloads, and then I'm going to hit OK. And you'll get a little pop-up that says Smart Form Export Created. The XML export file was created and it's located in this folder. That's the form will automatically generate a file name for it, so you do not need to name it. So then you just hit OK. And that's, let me just pull up my download. Real quick, I go to my downloads folder, and yep, I see this little file here. This file is what you are going to upload into OLDC if you are a state office. And notice the difference if it's an Excel file, right? You'll have the little icon that indicates it's Excel, but you're not uploading Excel, you're uploading XML. So the icon should be pretty blank like it is over here. And that's what you're gonna drag and drop into OLDC. And we do have an OLDC refresher on the 18th. So you'll be able to see what that process looks like. And for state agencies, again, we have step-by-step instructions for how to upload that into OLDC. So for today, I just wanted to show you how to create the XML that needs to be uploaded into OLDC. Now, moving on to the Module 4 Smart Form. What's the first thing you do, right? You look at that enable content button and make sure it is there. It is there. Check. So you want to hit that and give it a while to load. Depending upon how big the file is, it might just take a while for it to load there. But similar concept as Module 2, you have a general overview of the module on that first tab called Instructions. Because Module 4 is very extensive, we did build in a table of contents just to make it easy to toggle back and forth. If you know you'd need to get to the health NPIs, and instead of scrolling through all of the tabs and scrolling until you get to the health NPIs, you can just click on it and it'll automatically take you to where you need to go. We have buttons here. Again, if you need to go to the instructions, you could do that. Let's try that again. If you need to go to the table of contents, you can do that and it'll take you to the table of contents. So a lot of good toggling back and forth to make this as easy and friendly for you guys as possible. Let me go back there again, and you could also just toggle to the errors and warnings tab. So notice it is blank now, but just like module 2, as you complete the form, you will start to see errors and warnings become added to this tab over here. So let's go to the first tab. We start with employment NPIs. Notice there is a slight difference between module 2 and module 4. In module 2, you had your previous year data right there side by side, so you could see it there. That's because we do a lot of checks with the previous year data in module 2. We do not do as many checks with the previous year data in module 4, so we don't have it side by side, but we still have your previous year data built all the way at the end. So you want to scroll to the end, and all of this will be pre-populated with your fiscal year 19 numbers. So we have a tab for your NPIs, we have a tab for your services, we have a tab for your previous demographic information, and these three red tabs will come pre-populated with your 19 data. And the reason we've included those is just because we know a lot of agencies use the smart forms as tools for internal purposes also, and they want to be able to track those year-to-year changes themselves. And this tool just allows you to do that, even though we don't actually check for errors and warnings with the previous year data. The only data point for which we do check with the previous year data is in your all characteristics report, those first two items, A and B. We do check against your previous year data to make sure there's not a significant difference there, because we have to report at a national level what the total number of people served was, and we want to make sure that data is absolutely accurate. So that's the year-to-year comparison is available to you at the end of the SMART form. But let's go back. So you have your employment NPIs. And then one thing we did is right next to the NPIs for employment, now we made sure the services for employment show up right next to it. We've heard that that makes it easier for you to just focus on a domain at a time and to compare the data between your services and outcomes if they're right next to each other. So we heard you and we implemented those changes. Similar thing with errors and warnings. So let's say I'm going to put in a number, and look, automatically I already see some red, and red means that it must be addressed. And the reasoning over here is it tells me the row is incomplete. And let me actually make that bigger. I just realized how itty bitty that is. So it says the row is incomplete. And then just like in module 2, you just want to hover over that little triangle that tells you there's a comment there. And it tells you column 2 is required and column 3 is required. So similar functionality to module 2, and then you want to enter in that data. So let's say my target was 80, my actual was, let's say, 20. Okay, so notice we cleared the red there, right? Because now my row is complete and I have an okay signal right there. What's the blue highlighting? So for those that have used the SMART forms in years past, you'll know that we used to always check for columns 4 and column 5 if they were highlighted. So usually column 5 was the targeting accuracy. If it was outside of a certain range, that 80 to 120% range, that used to be flagged yellow and that used to be called out in the errors and warnings tab. Now, we've heard that, you know, a lot of times the targets are what the targets are, right? So it's not like you can change what your targets were retroactively. So it didn't really make sense to say this was an error or a warning. So notice we've removed it from the errors and warnings tab, right? So you see some highlighting here, but you don't see anything listed on the errors and warnings tab. That means that is not an error and warning that you need to address. The reason it's highlighted blue is, again, because a lot of agencies like to use the forms for internal purposes. Your state office might want to keep track of how you're doing on your targeting, right? And this might be a TNTA piece that you address internally at your agency, or that your state office maybe potentially addresses with you, right? But for the purpose of a data check, it is no longer considered an error and warning. So I'm sure many folks will breathe easy that they don't have to address all of those, you know, multiple instances when your targeting was slightly off, right? So no more of that check in module four. Other than that, you just want to go in, and similar to module two, your agency name, state, and DUNS should be pre-populated there, and it will be pre-populated on every tab. Some NPIs will be auto-calculated based off of what you put in the subsets of the NPIs, right? So you're really filling out 2C.1. And then the top row will auto-calculate what you put in based off of the subset rows, right? So no need to touch those, and you will not be able to enter data there, even if you wanted to. So just a little bit of a heads up. Yeah, so you go through, you fill it out, pretty easy peasy. Let me take you to the all characteristics. Let me make that bigger because that is very small. Let's say you put in 1,000 people. That's your total number of individuals that you've served. And then you're trying to tell us gender. And you're saying we had 400 male and 300 female. Notice that this is red. Most of the red that you see and when you're filling out the smart forms is going to show up in module four, the all characteristics report section C, because all of these totals in each subcategory, so you notice these totals need to add up and equal the total that you put in these items. So for section C, which is individual level characteristics, all of the categories there need to equal your item A. For section D, as we scroll down, all of these totals need to equal the total that you put in your item B for households, because section D talks about your household characteristics. And so what do you do here, right? You say, I know 400 of my 1,000 people are male. I know 300 of them are female. So then what happened to the 300 others? If you do not know, because you do not have that information on the 300 others, you put them in the unknown or not reported category. That way your total comes up to 1,000. And that way we remove all the errors and warnings there. So that's how you fill out module four. Now, what did I say? The last step you do is always go back to your outstanding errors and warnings. And as we filled it out, notice there are some errors and warnings here. That's because I did not finish completing these NPIs. Remember, I only put in the first column. I did not put in columns two and three. So I see these errors and warnings on my errors and warnings tab. If you're an agency, you want to address these before you submit to your state office. If you are a state office, you want to address these with your agency before you submit to OCS. So if you are a state office and you've done all that review back and forth with your agencies, you've supplied your state office with the Excel smart form, right? State offices, you need to do what you do for module two, which is export to an XML, and it's the exact same process. You click that button. You select the folder you want it to go into, you hit OK, and it will give you the little pop-up that says the XML export file was created. Here's where it's located. And you just hit OK, and then let me show that real quick again. Notice I see the XML here, and notice it doesn't have an Excel icon because it is not an Excel file. It is an XML file, and that is the file that you need to drag and drop and upload into OLDC, which again, we have an OLDC refresher on Thursday to walk you through that, and we have step-by-step instructions as well. So that is it for the module two and four demo for now. I'm going to go back to the slideshow. We will do the module three demo once we get there, but We have a few notes about reviewing your module 2 through 4 data before we move on to module 3. So hang on tight just one second while I get my slideshow again.
And that was great walkthrough, Muska. Super useful. I think one of the main things is that errors and warnings page that you showed us, right? That's where the magic happens. If you don't want a review memo, that's where the magic happens, because this is the bulk of what the federal review would consist of. I say the bulk because there are additional things that the federal review process looks like, and NASCASP has a checklist of all of those things located on our website. So there's some things that this form can't flag for, like, for example, we call them cross-modular checks, and we'll take a look at a couple of those and what that means. But generally speaking, I think somewhere around like 90% of what we would follow up on is right here in this errors and warnings tab. So state offices have various processes for receiving comments back from local agencies on data. You might want to check in with your state office of what that process looks like internally to communicate to them about what an error and how to explain an error and warning, so that they can provide that in the comments document that they submit along with their federal submission of this report. So again, check all the errors and warnings, use this tab. It's a great tool for you. Muska went over some of this flagging in her demo. I'm just going to reiterate what she said. Check the yellow boxes, they are warnings. We recognize that in warnings, data might be correct, right? But it's simply a flag. One of the things that we might look out for is also if there's the majority of funding in one domain, if there's no admin dollars, if there's funds and agency capacity building, but no detail, as in this screenshot that you see and that Muska explained. If you have questions about what that yellow warning is, you just hover over the cell and it'll give you guidance. You can also go back to that errors and warnings tab and take a look. Some other considerations in module 2 in section B are looking at volunteer hours. So in this example, actually I'll start with the agency capacity building, sorry. In B2 hours of agency capacity building, there's two different data points there. One is about board members in capacity building activities. The other one is about staff. So that yellow highlight there on B2A indicates a change from the previous year, a significant increase in this case. So it's just flagging it to make sure that you correctly entered the data. A comment that's sufficient for the federal review is, yes, this data was reviewed and it is correct and accurate. That is a sufficient comment. You can provide additional detail, but there is no need to. Our main goal, the federal review process's main goal, is to ensure that data was correctly entered. So in taking a look at B3, notice that these are both highlighted. And there's a couple of things going on here. One is previous year data. It's significantly less. The volunteer hours are significantly less than last year's. But also notice that B3A, the total number of volunteer hours and the total number of the volunteer hours from folks who have low incomes is exactly the same. Again, it could totally be possible that 100% of your volunteers are people with low incomes, but typically we see a subset here, right? Typically we see a subset here because board members are also included in volunteer hours, and not, in most cases, not all board members are represent low-income people, right? Or are low-income themselves. So some other flags to take a look at. The number of partners in Module 2, Section B, these will flag previous year data. So this is the number of of organizations that you partner with, right? We do have two automatic flags that Milska mentioned. One is on the state association and one is on the state office. Again, these are simply errors. We recognize that perhaps you don't work with your state association or you don't have a state association, right? But in most cases, CAAs work with their state association if they have one in their state, and you would have a one there. So it's flagged automatically. We see zero. Likewise with the state office, right? If nothing else, it is very likely you're working with your CSBG state office. So just some things to pay attention to there. We also have flags in section C. And this is probably where we see the most number of flags go off. And oftentimes what we find is somebody put data on the wrong row, right? It was meant to be on Head Start, but you put it on early Head Start or some mixed match like that. What we see flagged on your screen right now is, of course, year-to-year data, but also this idea that LIHEAP weatherization assistance, that money that states can transfer from LIHEAP to weatherization, is a subset of your regular LIHEAP allocation. So there's something going on here with this data. And again, the flags are simply to get your eye to it to make sure it's correct and accurate. And again, that is a perfectly acceptable reason for having data submitted with a warning message, right? Again, to Muska's point, those error messages are different, and 99% of the time are things that just cannot be, like a negative number, for example. One other note on Module 2, Section C is in these state allocated resources. There's a data point here called state appropriated funds used for same purpose as federal CSBG. We see a lot of different things in this data point, and we just want to point out that this is intended for local agencies to report on money they receive from their state legislature that is earmarked to be used as CSBG. There are really only a few states in the country whose legislatures appropriate funds in this way. So if you have money here, make sure it's from that pot of money and it's not from discretionary money that your state appropriated or some other special type of grant from your state office. Just pay attention there. And Module 4 considerations. So let's take a look at some of the Module 4 considerations now. I think Muska went over quite a bit of this in her demo, so I will just keep it quick, but always pay attention to those errors and warnings. Notice missing targets, notice missing outcomes. The other thing is we saw a lot last year that there might be a target. Somebody submitted data with a target, but there was no participants served and there were no actual results. So if you thought something was going to happen in the beginning of the year and then it didn't materialize, there is no need to submit only the target. Again, this is an outcomes report, so we want to see outcomes submitted. So just a note there. This idea of relationship between participants served and services, so this is what I was talking about with those cross-modular flags that aren't flagged in your SMART form, yellow or red, but they are things that we take a look at. And again, we recognize that there are many reasons why things may not line up as we think they might in our minds in terms of how business is done on the local level. But again, just something to pay attention to. If we are seeing numbers served in the employment NPIs, for example, we are expecting to see services in the employment domain. Having said that, you might have services in services supporting multiple domains or some other domain that contribute to the people being served in that employment domain. But most of the time, we're expecting to see some services there that have a general relationship with those people served in the NPIs. So pay attention to that. Maybe you're missing some services or you have some other explanation as to what's going on in that relationship. Note those indicators that are specific to children aged 0 to 5. Make sure that you're seeing those folks in your all characteristics report, right? So in this example, we're seeing, what is that? 5,000, thank you, 5,000 on children age 0 to 5 obtaining an outcome, right? But if we go and we take a look at the all characteristics report, we're only seeing 597. So something's going on there that the folks aren't ending up in all characteristics. Again, we recognize data interoperability issues. You may not, that might be Head Start data, and you can't get the Head Start database to align with yours, for example, so you can't report the people. Just something to be keeping an eye out for. Likewise, if you have outcomes in Head Start, we would expect to see those children being served in the Head Start service, right? We also take a look at money. So if we see that an agency has Head Start dollars, we want to ensure that they're reporting the services and the outcomes as well. Again, we recognize all of the various issues. These are just things that we're keeping an eye out for. Another cross-modular check is FNPI 5B, improved physical health and well-being. If that number matches the number of food boxes in 5JJ, we're going to flag that. And why is that? It's not likely that everybody who got a food box improved their physical health and well-being. So again, it's possible. We aren't at the local agency doing the work that you're doing to obtain that information. So again, it is likely, but it's not always, it's not likely, it's possible, but not necessarily likely. So something else to pay attention to. There's those indicators that are specific to seniors age 65 and up. Again, just make sure that you're seeing those folks in your all characteristics report, right? A note on FNPI 7A. This is probably the most misunderstood NPI out there. If it were a dating game, that's what this NPI would be. But what NPI 7A is the unduplicated count of people who obtained at least one outcome, okay? They could have obtained more outcomes, but they obtained at least one. Anybody who got an outcome is unduplicated and counted once in FNPI 7A. So this is not a program of its own. It's the indicator to show the impact of community action in your communities. The other check you can do here to make sure that this number is more or less jiving is noting that it should at least be as high as the highest number reported for an FNPI. So in this example, you've got 1,229 children reported an FNPI 2B. So we should see at least that number in 7A. And the last thing to note about Module 4 is what we saw Muska's example show us. You're going to get those flags on that all characteristics report. So pay attention to them and utilize those unknown not reported fields. So I'm going to turn it over to Muska at this point.
Before we move on, I did see a couple really excellent questions, and I just wanted to make sure we address those real quick. So there was a question about
Muska, the errors. Muska, giving timing, I think we should get through the presentation and then we can try to get to questions at the end.
Sure. We can do that. All right. So then let's move on. So I did see a question asking about how do we let our state office know if something is correct, et cetera, and that leads us to comments. We have provided every state office with a template that they could use for comments. We haven't mandated it, but it is a template and it just will make it easier and more streamlined if folks use the template. And if you're a state office on the call, you'll see that this looks a lot like the review memo that you get back, right? So it's essentially the same functionality. You can select your state, agency, module, section, data point. Then we have dropdowns built in for standard error and warning messages that you typically see. And then you could write in your justification there. So that template was shared with every state office. If you are a local agency, you can use that template, but you should also check in with your state office on what their process is for getting comments from you. But the idea basically is that if you see errors and warnings, and you've addressed them, but you're still seeing certain errors and warnings at the time that you're about to submit to your state office, the data is correct, but it's being flagged for whatever reason, and you want to let your state office know that that data is in fact correct, you provide a comment in you know, potentially this comment template to let them know what the data point is, let them know what the message is that you're seeing, and then let them know that, yes, we have verified this data point and it is in fact correct. So that would be the way how you can inform your state office. But like I said, check in with your state office around exactly what their process is going to be around that. If you are a state office, and also if you're an agency and you are providing comments, please review those comments and make sure those are in fact good to go, because they will be forwarded to us at the national level. And one thing we've noticed as we go through comments is sometimes the agency may not be addressing the actual error and warning. So they notice the data point is flagged and maybe there's an assumption made about why it's flagged, and that's what they're addressing when the actual error is telling you that there's something else actually going on, and it will tell you what that is. So make sure that you're addressing what the error is asking you to address. Other things we've seen is sometimes the agencies are communicating sort of preliminary information that you share with your state office to provide contacts or maybe something, but it's not necessarily appropriate for that final data submission that goes on to OCS. So if you're a state office, you know, there's just some preliminary information like that that is not necessarily relevant to the error or warning. Just make sure you've reviewed for those, and that review, that comment template that you upload is actually your final comment template. And sometimes the agency's response may not resolve the issue. So if you're a state office and you're reviewing, make sure you actually do try to resolve the error and warning with your agency before you submit to OCS. As I mentioned earlier, we used to call out if your targeting was outside of that 80 to 120% benchmark. We're no longer calling it out in the review memo, so no need to comment on that as you're uploading your data. Those are the things that are highlighted blue. Again, they're highlighted blue just to flag them for your internal purposes, but no need to make a comment about them. And so those two things are the targeting and also NPIs where all targeted outcomes were obtained. That's another thing that we've highlighted blue and that we're no longer calling out in a review memo and therefore no longer are expecting you to comment on. So that should hopefully make this so much easier for you guys. So with that, let's get into module three real quick. So with module three, let me just do a quick demo actually at this point. So let me get out of my slideshow again.
Yeah, and as you're bringing that up, I can just talk very briefly about module three. Nothing has changed in terms of functionality, but Miska's got it up and we'll show you the things that have, or things to pay attention to.
Yeah. So again, what's the first thing you do? Enable content. And the reason that's critical for module three, even though module three doesn't really have errors and warnings, notice there's no error and warning tab, and module three is also not an XML that gets uploaded. Module three is actually the one form where you do upload the Excel file. The content is still important because there is still coding that's built in as you're completing the form. So you want to go to the status form, and this is really the main thing you're going to be working off of. We did add some new dropdowns for this year. And so in order to enter data in here, so let's say you want to enter in what your initiative name is Give me a sec. Sure, got it. You want to hit the edit button. Give it a second. I think my module 3 is being a bit wonky. Module 3 is a bit of a beast because there's a lot of coding and stuff built into it. So it sometimes takes a while. And I think my module 3 is frozen right now, if I'm not mistaken. And that will happen to you too. For those who actually have worked off of module 3, it will very much freeze on you because there's just a lot of coding on here. So you just want to pause. Give it some time. Anyways, as it's taking time to think, I'll just continue doing the talking. you'll have step-by-step instructions on our website. So, you know, for any narrative field, you want to hit the edit button next to it, and it'll pop up a little place where you could start typing in your narrative, and that's how you want to do it. Notice these are checkboxes for the domains that are relevant to your initiative. All of the forms come pre-checked with all of the domains. Unfortunately, I cannot show it to you on screen right now, but let's say your initiative is only employment. So you would uncheck all of the domains except for employment. And what that does is at the bottom, see all the colored tabs for each domain. Those are all going to disappear except for employment. So once you select your domain, the only tabs you should be seeing at the bottom should be the tabs that are relevant to your domain. And so you do that, then you want to select your NPIs and you click on this and there will be a pop-up that tells you what your NPIs are. And again, in that pop-up, you will only be able to see the NPIs in the domain that you selected. So if we select employment, you will only see the employment NPIs listed. You check those and then close it, fill out the rest of this. It's a mix of narratives and drop-downs. You come to your strategy, similar thing as the NPIs. You want to click on it, it'll do a pop-up, and then you just select your strategies based off of the domain. So again, if you selected employment, you're just going to see the employment strategies. You're also going to see the strategies in that seventh domain because the seventh domain support any other domain out there. And that's how you go about filling out this form. Now, usually what I've seen happen is agencies stop at the status form, but you actually have to go into those other tabs as well. So if you selected employment, you selected your employment NPIs, you do need to click on your employment tab and fill in your data for your NPIs. So everybody should have some minimal amount of data, right, which is your target. Everybody should, for the most part, right, have a target identified. So if you do have a target identified, you need to enter that in your employment tab in the NPI that you have a target for and say, this is what we're targeting. You may not have your actual outcomes yet, right? Because community work takes time. But if you do have your actuals, you can put in your actuals as well on this tab at the bottom. If you're working with rates of change, you might need to put in baseline data, right? So a rate of change is when you're addressing a statistic. So you're saying, I know the unemployment rate is this percent at the moment that we started the initiative. So you want to put that baseline data in there. You want to put your target in there. So long story short, the status form is where 90% of your data entry goes, but you also want to go on the tabs at the bottom to input any information you might have for your NPIs. So with that, we just have resources left to show you. So let me pull up the slideshow again. Okay, so we actually do have a screenshot on our slideshow. So that's what the pop-ups will look like. Sorry that it didn't work, but that is the reality of how Module 3 sometimes works. It just requires patience. So that's what the pop-ups will look like, just FYI. And again, we do have a really good step-by-step instruction on our website. So you can actually see what I was trying to explain to you today. So some resources, we have a lexicon that just gives you definitions. If you're confused about what an NPI is asking for, we have instruction manuals that also guide you through how to put in data, where, you know, what are definitions for certain things, where does it make sense to put in certain data. We have FAQs that we put out there and just lots of other resources. So multiple FAQs, crosswalks, if you're doing LIHEAP or Head Start or weatherization, we actually have a really neat crosswalk that tells you, well, here are NPIs and services that you could fill out if you have a Head Start program. We do have a list of other indicators. If you want to write in an indicator that is not in that standard set of indicators, you check out this list. We actually do have some suggestions for other indicators you could put in that we basically curated from the network, from seeing what other folks wanted to put in as other indicators. Review checklist. I did see a question about, does the smart form catch everything? So the errors and warnings tab will catch everything that is highlighted, but not everything that we look at will be highlighted. So some of those cross-modular, cross-sectional checks that Katie walked you through, the form does not do that for you, like comparing your NPIs to your services. That requires a human eye to do that. So that checklist tells you what all of those additional things are. So those will not be highlighted in your form, and therefore they will not show up on your errors and warnings tab. But if something is highlighted on your form, it will always show up on your errors and warnings tab. We also have a review checklist for module 3 along with other stuff. So here's our website. You just want to go to CSBG, data collection reporting, and then annual report. And with that, we have 1 minute left to address any questions. Although I do think I addressed some of the most popular questions.
I believe you requested quite a few. We are going to extend a little bit for those of you who can stay on to listen to the question and answer portion. But we do want to be cognizant of your time. So I will quickly go through the questions and either myself, Katie, or Muska will respond. The first question is, has the national theory of change been updated to include equity? Where can we find it? So at this time, there is no, we haven't discussed updating the national theory of change. So there is no update available, but I will say just because something's not included in the national theory of change, that does not mean that it's not intended to be included. So, and the national theory of change does serve as a guidance or guideline. It's not a, it doesn't necessarily capture everything. So again, at this time, the national theory of change has not been updated. We had two questions about the blue cells. And did you talk about what those mean? And I think they're talking about the formatting for GD.
Yeah, so those blue highlights, again, they're only going to show up in module 4, the NPIs. And that was the, I guess my Excel is just frozen in general. But those were, again, those things that I mentioned that are just for internal review only. So they're flagged just to let you know, hey, your targeting is a little off, or hey, you said 100% of people achieve the outcome. But that's all that that is. It's just something for you to address internally and take a look at it, but it is not something that will show up in the errors and warnings tab. And it is not something that needs to be addressed for the purpose of data submission.
And I just want to add to it that is not a comment on that being an important check, right? If you're following ROMA, if you're following performance management, targeting success is a key indicator of agency success, right? Right, knowing what goes into your program. So I think it's really important to still pay attention to those targets. But this is more of a TA item between a state office and a local agency than it is to ensure data quality at the federal level.
Absolutely.
We have a few questions about the March 18th webinar. We did send the invite for that on Thursday, March 11th. You should have received an email from CSBG States. If you did not receive that email, you can contact me directly. Again, my name is Monique Alcantara, and I will include my email address in the chat box. That webinar is primarily for states because it's part of the process where they're submitting it to OLDC, and that really is just for the states. But again, I'll email in the chat function. This is for Katie or Muska. Upon review of the module 2 error and warnings, how do we let our state office know? that the data is correct as confirmation that they can disregard the related warnings. We put that note in the body of the email when we submit the report. And I believe Muska did address this as part of her conversation about the comments.
That's really a state process though too, right? I mean, how a state collects from the local might look different from how states submit comments to OCS. So I would ask your state office.
Yeah. And I just put the comments template up again in case your state does use the comments template. That's how you would address that.
We only received modules 2 and 4, but not module 3. When will we be getting module 3?
So everybody should have received their module 3. If this is from a state office, please reach out to Paige and CC me and we'll be able to get those to you ASAP. If that's a local agency asking, I would reach out to your state office because they might not have had a chance to distribute those out yet.
The next question is, do we report regular annual CSBG cares and supplemental separately or everything together? If all together, does money get separated out or all in together? So this is a multi-question and I can start and Katie and Muska, feel free to jump in as well. So we have 3 separate reports, but for your regular CSBG annual report, you should be reporting on all CSBG funding and services as you would normally do for the CSBG annual report. For the CARE specific report and the disaster specific report for those who applies to, you should only be reporting on services and funds that were supported by that funding stream, so CARES or disaster. And we are gonna do more webinars that focus on the CARES and disaster supplemental forms, but the short answer is for the regular annual report, include everything. And then we got a similar question, and I am going to ask Katie Musker to help out on this to make sure that I understood it correctly. I just wanted to confirm that we are only reporting out what we identify as priorities for the CSBG funding and goals for module 4. Is that correct? go ahead, Katie.
Well, I think I know what that question means. Like, so maybe you have CSBG priorities that you identified in a needs assessment process or strategic planning process. You certainly report out on those, but the CSBG annual report reports out across all your agency programs, right? So that's why we were talking about Head Start outcomes and services and WIOA and whatever other programs your agency might run. Now, your state might ask you something specific about CSBG goals or something along those lines, and that might be for a different purpose, but certainly for the report itself, report everything.
And that might also, there's always a bit of nuance. If you're a public CAP, right, just check in with your state office how they want you to report. In module 4, but for the most part, if you're not a public CAP and you're a private CA, you are reporting for everything across, whether it's directly CSBG or not. And public CAPs, it just becomes a little bit tricky because if you're a local government body, how big do you get, right? At what point do you stop counting or start counting?
And certainly contact your state office if you've got questions that are more specific than that.
So Muska, if you want to go back to the slide about considerations about, we do have a question that about module 2 C.4A, and they want to know, can you explain again what funds are recorded here?
So some state legislatures appropriate state general funds that are earmarked to be used exactly the same as CSBG federal dollars. Right. So they're saying, hey, these are our taxpayer generated general funds. We want this dollar amount to be used as CSBG. So state offices receive that general fund money, put it through their same CSBG allocation, and grant the money to local agencies. Now, there's only a handful of 8 to 10 states, I think, that have general funds appropriated this way. Those are the only dollars that should be reported there. So if you receive other grants that is still federal CSBG, like some states grant out their discretionary dollars for certain projects or things along those lines, you would put that in the federal dollar section. This is only your state general fund. Again, this impacts only like 8 to 10 states, I think, which is why we're bringing it up, because we've seen money here for at least 75 to 80% of the country. So.
Thanks, Katie. We do, Muska, can you go back to slide 4? People are asking to see Paige's contact information again in case they did not receive the smart form. So I just wanted to display it there, and we'll also add it to the chat.
And this is for state offices. So if you're a local agency and you haven't received your smart form, the first person to contact is your state office. And again, give them a couple of days, because they literally just got them on Friday. So they may not have had time to do their quality assurance and get the, you know, get them out. Like, it could be a lot of work depending on the size of your state. So if you're a state office and haven't received the forms, reach out to Paige and Muska.
Thank you. We've received a few questions about whether or not the slides will be sent. We will be posting the slides as well as the recording on the OCS website, which we will share more information about that on Thursday if you're not familiar with the website. And we will likely send it out through a DCL as well. And I believe NASCAS will also post the slides on their website. So we will be showing the slides. The recording will take a little bit longer to post, but we will also be posting the recording on the OCS website. In module 3, will any of our previous narratives and data be pre-populated? I think this is an important question to ask, because it is a little different than modules 2 and 4, where it's specific to the state, but not necessarily to the initiative or the L2. Oh, it's specific to L2 entity. Go ahead, Ms. Dice, you nodding your head, so you can clarify.
Yeah, module 3 does not come pre-populated with your previous narratives, but module 3 also hasn't changed significantly, so you might just need to update the narratives in your previous submission and update that information there, but no, it does not come pre-populated.
But they are able to use the copy and paste function, so they wouldn't have to retype, correct?
Yes.
Our next question is, how do I add rows to section E on the all characteristics tab, or if I can't, where would I include those additional programs? So I believe there's 15 rows and section E for, well, in module 4, section C, tab E, however we want to refer to it. I don't really know how to respond.
You can't add rows.
Yeah, we know we can't add them, but I don't know. I guess they could work with their state on.
Yeah, I mean, I think it just depends on what the funds are that are being reported there. If they can't be included in the data set above, maybe your state office has some fixes or some suggestions or some prioritization of what to report. I mean, that could also just be the answer. So kudos to you for having that many programs. I think that's awesome.
And do we want to explain more about section E, the unduplicated counts that go there, or do we want to leave that conversation for another day? I see your faces. We'll leave that conversation right now.
Yeah, I think it's more helpful. We've got some visualizations that kind of help conceptualize, and without them, I feel like it's challenging to explain.
Yeah.
If folks have questions, feel free to follow up with us, and we can share out.
And we've posted webinars, even some of that content that we went through earlier with things to look out for as you're reviewing the data, stuff of that sort. We've done webinars on it before, and those should be posted on our website. So check those out and check out again the instruction manual for further explanation on what section E and F are in module four.
That goes to are the latest instructions for the annual report on the website. Yes, they are. How about the comment template?
Well, the comment template is not on the website. We should get that uploaded ASAP. So that will be accessible on the website. We did make some tweaks to the manuals that are not shared publicly at this moment. They're with OCS, but those tweaks are really related to all of those questions we're getting around how to report CARES in your regular report, right? So that is in the works, and we're hoping that we can get that out. But there are no significant changes to the overall instructions from previous years for the annual report.
Okay, we have three more questions, one of which I think we responded to, which is just, again, the errors and tabs warning does capture all the errors and warnings within the module, but does not catch the errors and warnings that we will be reviewing, like put our actual human eye to during the federal review process. For agencies that have programs that don't necessarily capture its service, such as domestic abuse, is there a particular service you're looking forward to account for its income? Which I think this is a more, this might need like a little bit more.
So that's really a content-based question. So if there's an outcome you are trying to track, you can write in an outcome in the report. If it's a service that's not captured in the standard set of services, you actually do not have an option to write in your own service. That service list is pretty extensive. So I, you know, do try to go through it and see if it could go in case management or whatever, you know, service that is. But at the end of the day, if you cannot capture it in the services, then, you know, it just won't get reported there. And that's fine because it's a standard form. So there might be, you know, things here and there that do not necessarily get reported in the standard form.
And our final question, thanks guys for hanging in there with us for an extra 15 minutes. Is there a reason that targeting was no longer being focused on? And I'm not sure that that is accurate, but.
Yeah, it is just that idea that the federal review is simply looking for incorrect data, right? You know, somebody fat fingered something, or they put it on the wrong line, or whatever, whatever the issue might be. And the targeting is very important. It's performance management, it's training and technical assistance. It's key that we all collectively do well with performance targeting, right? But again, we found that we're not catching bad data necessarily. So we've placed it in the TNTA category there.
And just to underscore that, right, the main reason is because then error and warning just means the data needs to be updated potentially, right? But if your targets are set before you begin the program, so you won't be changing your target. And that's why we removed it as an error and warning, because there's nothing to update there. It is what it is. Either you exceeded it, you met it, or you didn't meet it. And so that's why we still flag it, as Katie said, because it is still critical for you to take a look at that.
It's just to clarify, it's flagged during the federal review, not necessarily in the forms, right?
No, so it's only flagged in the smart form as that blue highlighting, which again, just to draw your attention to it, but in the federal review, because we're trying to catch bad data or incorrect data, or however you want to say that in the review process, we don't call it out in the federal review because we're not expecting you to change that data point since your targets were set long ago.
But to clarify, I meant that we do pay attention to it in a sense that we'll consider future TNTA if we're seeing that the targets are seeming to be off base year to year. So that's what we're looking for during the federal review. And with that, there are no more questions. Thank you everyone for attending. We are going to share this this presentation very shortly, as well as the recording. So just be on the lookout for that, and we hope to see you guys on Thursday.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
See ya.
Bye.